Good evening, AWPM family and friends. We're excited to have you here with us tonight. This is your senior pastor, Marcus Rogers Sr., and I am co-pastor, Prophetess Mikaela Rogers. And we're just going to jam out to some music. We know that this is a holy week in celebration of Jesus and his awesome resurrection. Amen. So we're going to celebrate with this music right here. And the song is called Matthew 28. We do not own the copyrights to the music. Amen. But we're going to jam to this. Amen. While we're waiting for you to come in and to invite your friends in, invite your family in, we got a good word tonight, y'all. This word going to hit hard. It's going to bring some awareness to you. Amen.
Hallelujah and good evening. Praise the Lord, everyone. We're ready for a powerful night. Abiding Word Prophetic Ministries here. Pastor Marcus Rogers, First Lady Mikaela Rogers. We call her Mickey. Hallelujah. We just want to give y'all a few minutes to come on in. Come on in, come on in. To God be the glory. This is a powerful, powerful week. This is the week of all weeks. Hallelujah. Y'all come on in.
Click on the video, baby.
And just put the
was as white as snow.
His countenance was like lightning,
and his brain was as white as snow. Aisha, mwah. Love y'all. Excited to have y'all here tonight. We're going to get into it soon. Jam out to the worship. He said, fear not. Fear not. For I know. He is not here, for he has risen as he said.
See the place where the Lord is.
Hallelujah. Amen.
See the place where the Lord
is. Let's review the story one more time. The Lord spoke to the women and said, Fear not.
For I know ye seen Jesus who was crucified.
He is not here.
He is not here.
He is not here.
He is not here.
Why are you looking for the living among the dead?
He is not here.
He is not here.
For he has risen as he said.
Come see the place where the Lord.
Hallelujah. Come on.
See the place where the Lord lay.
Remember how he said. Woo. While he was yet in Galilee.
Remember how he said
while he was yet
in Galilee. Come on, I'll rise.
What did he say, surprise?
I'll rise. I'll rise again. I'll rise
Come on. Hallelujah. Amen.
Come on. Invite and share. Come on. I'll rise again. Hallelujah. Come on, y'all. Hallelujah. Woo! Death couldn't hold them down, y'all.
You can have that, Ricky Dillon.
Hey! Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. How y'all doing tonight? Mwah, mwah, mwah. We love you, we love you, we love you. Welcome to tonight's service, y'all. You know this is our Bible study. So you know we're not going to try to hold you too long, but we got a word tonight. Whew. This word right here, it's no joke. This word is going to hit you. It's going to hit you good. It's going to hit you in a good way. Amen. Because we all need to hear it. We all need to be aware of it. So many times it's easy to make the word of God confusing because we want to add the big words and we want to add to it, maybe take away from it and all these things, but we're warned not to do that because our name could be taken away from the Lamb's Book of Life. And so we are not going to do that. Instead, we are going to make it simple, just as God wants it. Amen. It doesn't have to be complex. You just have to listen. You just have to read. And God will give it to you just as easy as that. Just keep the heart right. That's it. Amen. Everybody type, amen, 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 amen. Hallelujah. So we seeing everybody coming in and we love you. We're excited to spend this time with you. As we've already said, co-pastor here, Mikaela Rogers, and this is your senior pastor, Marcus Rogers, senior. Amen.
Good evening. Praise the Lord, everyone.
And so we're going to go ahead and jump into this relevant, relatable, and real word. Amen. Now, everybody, I want you to put your hand up in the comments. You got your notebook, you got your pen, you got your Bible or your Bible app. Come on, y'all. Y'all know what? Come on. We're teachers. You know this is a teaching ministry because you are going to be matured and learn how to depend on God. Learn how to look to God. Never to man, but to God. Amen. So, come on. Let us know you're ready. Let us know you're ready. We looking. We want to see it. Come on. Hey, Miss Keisha Anderson.
Mwah. Ooh, cuz. What's up?
Hey, cuz. Excited to have y'all here tonight. Come on. Ah, Shelton. Mwah. Love you. Come on, everybody. Let us know you're ready. Get your water bottles. Get your water bottles and everything ready so you ain't got to get up or nothing. Come on. We getting ready to get in this word. And like I said, we don't hold long because we get straight to the meat of the matter. Amen. So, with that being said, let me go ahead and get this right here. Make sure Pastor has the word so he can read it out for me. Amen.
Amen.
And tonight, as we know, our Bible study has began. It began last week, and it was on what? Personal boundaries. We learned some things, so we're just going to do a quick overview, okay? Quick overview. It's on boundaries. And our theme scriptures were from Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. And we learned that a boundary is a limit of a subject or sphere of activity, a line that marks the limits of an area, a dividing line, something that fixes a limit or extent. Also, from the book of Acts, chapter 17, verse 26, the word boundaries in the Greek is the word harathasia. Again, it's the Greek word harathasia, and it means laying down limits, a definite limit, properly setting of limits. There is a difference. This is a proper setting of limits. Amen. And we learned what the word hedge meant. Hedge, H-E-D-G-E. And that meant a fence or boundary that shut in for formation, protection, or restraint. As we find in Job chapter 1, verse 10, there was a hedge around Job. Amen. Excuse me. In the Hebrew, the word for hedge is the word suk. It is the word suk. And also, hedges are formed by something in particular, and so are the boundaries formed by something in particular. And we learned that that was what? That something is the word of God. Amen. So, just doing a quick overview. I'm not going too slow on the overview. We're going to take more time in what's being discussed tonight. Point number one last week was that boundaries are godly. Boundaries are godly. God was the very first one who instituted definite limits in the Garden of Eden. Also, the boundary God set was not to control Adam and Eve. It wasn't for the purpose of controlling. Understand that. You got to have the proper perspective when looking at boundaries. He was not trying to control them, but to protect and preserve them from what? From the evil that would be unleashed upon their lives, upon all mankind, if they crossed that boundary. Keep that in mind. When you're looking at boundaries, when you look at God's word, it's not a book of a bunch of do's and don'ts and how my life is to be restrained. No, it's not about that. Proper perspective. When you stay in the boundaries of God's word, you will understand that he is trying to protect and preserve you from the wickedness that is out here in these streets, from the wickedness of the enemy that will be unleashed upon you if you so choose to step outside of the bounds of God's love. Amen. Type amen if you're with me, if you're still with us. Also, we must become skilled at using boundaries. We ourselves must become skilled at using boundaries. If God found it important to put boundaries in place with relationships, how can we not see boundaries as something important to institute? Think about that. If God was the one who said, okay, let me put limits in here, I gotta do this for protection and preservation of relationship, to keep evil from getting in, how can we not turn around and say, okay, I'm going to have to put boundaries in place around my life and in my relationships to protect and preserve them and to keep my life from being ran around by the enemy. Amen. Also, we talked about the fact that boundaries help to keep things in proper perspective. Understand something. Eve herself lost proper perspective of her relationship with God when she stepped outside of the boundaries. We're going to go deeper into that tonight. But understand, Eve lost proper perspective of who God was in her life. She lost it when she had a relationship, when she then turned and had a relationship with the enemy. That was a relationship that was never supposed to be formed. She stepped outside of the bounds of God's word, entertaining something that she never should have entertained. And she received intellect, evil intellect, that she never should have tapped into it.
Come on here.
Why should she be tapping into, ooh, something that's supposed to kill me all of a sudden looks so good to me? That's wicked. That's wicked intellect. That's something that all of us have tapped into because of what happened in the garden. Improper perspective, and it caused us to lose relationship with God. So we continue. Also, our point number two of last week was boundaries are formed and created by the word of God.
Yes.
People of God, we must understand that God didn't take a marker and draw a line around the tree that he said to stay away from. What God spoke to Adam, what he spoke to Eve, that created the boundary in the realm of the spirit. What was said, as they say now, I said what I said. What God said is what he said, and that created the boundary. There was no need to go past that. It created the boundary markers in the realm of the spirit around that tree. It didn't have to be drawn out. Amen. So also, that means for you and me, when we're talking about boundaries, we learned that a boundary is what? Definite. It's not to be read in the mind. So when we have relationships with people, when we're dealing with people, we got to become skilled in speaking definites. I do not like it when. Not, no. You have to be definite and very intentional about the boundaries that you set. You cannot leave questions available. It cannot be an open-ended conversation. It has to be definite. Amen. And also, most importantly, your boundaries must be identical to God's. Must be. You can't create some out of this world, crazy foolishness type of boundary stuff. For example, something that me and Pastor were talking about. What's his name? Steve Harvey, for instance. And yes, I said his name. Oh, well, because he's big about this. Mr. Steve Harvey talks about this 3-month rule that a woman should not give herself up sexually to a man until 3 months has passed. Then she can give it up to him. I'm sorry. What boundary does that resemble in God's word? God says, do not fornicate. That means sex outside of marriage. There's a boundary. Definite. It is definite. It is not questionable. Could it be? If you're questioning it, you're acting like Eve and you're close to committing sin. There is nothing to be questioned. It's a definite boundary marker. He said, do not fornicate. 3 months? Really, 3 months. You're going to create that boundary in your life? 3 months is all it takes for a male predator. He'll wait you out. And on that third month, jump right between your legs, or she'll sit right on top of your lap. It just is what it is. It'll happen, and then they'll go on about their business. And they'll look at you as a what? Conquest. And not only that, but something else is taking place in the spirit. Because you cannot sin against God. You cannot transgress the boundary. You cannot go over the boundary and it not cost you something. And it not cost that person something. It is spiritual law. Do you hear this? Do you feel this? Do you agree with the word of God? Because this isn't just my teaching. So now, That is the overview of what we discussed last week. Because we're laying foundation, everybody. We're laying foundation. Even tonight, we're still laying foundation. But due to the week that it is, there's a different focus tonight as we're going deeper. Amen. So tonight, we are still within the boundary series. But tonight, the title that we are going to go by is Broken Boundaries Created a Broken Humanity. Again, I will say, the title focus for tonight is Broken Boundaries Created a Broken Humanity. And also with a special focus of the process to breaking the boundaries. Because there's a process that we go through before we transgress. There is a process. Or you could say the process to transgression. And still again, if you got your Bibles, your Bible apps, your pens, your pads, let's go. Theme scripture reading. Once again, Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. And it reads, "The serpent," and this is the New Living Translation, by the way, just so you know. "The serpent was the shrewdest of all the wild animals the Lord God had made. One day he asked the woman, 'Did God really say you must not eat the fruit from any of the trees in the garden?' 'Of course we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden,' the woman replied. 'It's only the fruit from the tree in the middle of the garden that we are not allowed to eat. God said you must not eat it or even touch it. If you do, you will die.' 'You won't die,' the serpent replied to the woman. 'God knows that your eyes will be open as soon as you eat it, and you will be like God, knowing both good and evil.' The woman was convinced. She saw that the tree was beautiful and its fruit looked delicious. She wanted the wisdom it would give her. So she took some of the fruit and ate it. Then she gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it too. At that moment, their eyes were opened, and they suddenly felt shame at their nakedness. So they sewed fig leaves together to cover themselves." And that is the reading of the theme scriptures of God's word. And Father, we just thank you for your awesome word, for opening our eyes to your revelation, for helping us with the simplicity, God, the simplicity that we would not transgress continually against you. In Jesus' holy name. Everybody, you're going to get a good understanding tonight. You're going to get this. You're going to get this, and you'll be able to teach this. But first, you got to eat this before you teach it. Amen. Now, I want you to take an inventory of everything. I always want you to take an inventory of your life personally. But just think about this. We live in a world where immorality and pushing the envelope is always encouraged and applauded. That's a dangerous thing. Very dangerous thing. You know, look at the TikTok challenges, the dangerous challenges that people are being encouraged to do. Pastor and I saw, I think it was last year or the year before that, they had some type of challenge where they were being encouraged to try to set themselves on fire. Mm-hmm. Remember that?
Yeah, oh yeah.
encouraged to set themselves on fire, and some of them went completely wrong. Crazy. They set themselves on fire and they couldn't immediately put it out. They began to panic and they were running, ran, jumped in the shower, suffering third degree burns, could have killed themselves, or even worse, put the whole house on fire, killed everybody. But these things are applauded. My God. Think about the women and the children that are being kidnapped, being forced into sex slavery. And that alone is a $1 billion industry. Industry. They look at it as business. You're selling soul, you're selling off people's bodies forcibly. They're not agreeing to this. This isn't just prostitution. You're kidnapping little boys, little girls, grown women, and you're selling them. Getting them high on what God knows what. Getting them high so they don't even know what's going on. And they're being sold to have sex with the highest bidder. And this is getting billions of dollars a year. Disgusting. They have award shows for pornography. Do you hear me? It goes beyond the Grammys. It goes beyond the MTV Movie Awards and all these kinds of things out here. Lord knows those things are just hot mess. But we got award shows for the best sex scene? For who can moan the best? Who bent over the best? Really? You got strip clubs. You got the XXX stores on every corner. And you already know what goes on in there. Horrific, hurtful to God, breaking his heart. All of these things are doing what? Crossing the boundaries, transgressing God's law. This was not what God had in mind for us to experience in the human experience. This was not God's way. And if you just look around, you look at it all, what do you call it? It's called brokenness. We're broken. We're a broken humanity. People cuss like it's regular everyday talk. I could say, "Hi, how are you doing? God bless you." Somebody else walk up, "What the F up, my N?" That's not God's way of talking. Mm-hmm. He didn't introduce that.
No.
When him and Adam were walking in the cool of the day, he didn't say, "Adam, my N, where are you?" Brokenness got into the human experience by breaking God's boundaries. And like I said, due to this being a holy week, with the resurrection absolutely being celebrated this weekend, whoo, thank you, Jesus, we are going to look at this sad condition that we're dealing with. Amen. So stick with us tonight. Stick with us. We're going to move through this thing fluidly. Amen. Now we've established tonight's importance and the weight it carries, we are going to move over into our first point. Keep in mind, we are still in the book of Genesis chapter 3, with the verses 1 through 7 being our focus. Point number 1 is giving an ear to a contrary voice. Again, point number 1 is giving an ear to a contrary voice. We see this in Genesis chapter 3, verse 1. This is where we see the serpent was the shrewdest of all the wild animals the Lord had made. One day he asked the woman, did God really say you must not eat the fruit from any of the trees in the garden? Listen, just because you may have heard something, it doesn't mean that you need to give it your attention. Like I said, just because you heard something doesn't mean that you need to give it your attention. If you're gonna give it your attention, this is what you do. You need to check it and correct it with what you heard God say. If you got something coming to question you, oh, did God really say? It's because it wants to test your limits. You check and correct with what? With what God has said. You hear something contrary to what you know to be true. You check it and you correct it with what God has said, not with a beautiful idea you've come up with. Not with something beautiful you've drummed up in your mind. No, you check it and correct it with what God said. And remember that if you have already heard from God on a matter, meaning you have his word on it, there is nothing more to discuss. Don't you let a contrary voice talk to you any further. There's nothing more to discuss. If you have God's word, you have his counsel concerning a matter. If God said, don't fornicate, and you hear, but baby, I love you. You mean so much to me. Making love to you is everything. Oh, I'm sorry. What is that? A contrary voice. Mm-hmm. And we know that words are not just words. Jesus said, what about his words?
I said, my words are spirit and they are life.
Say that again.
My words are spirit and they are life.
Which means that words don't just come from anywhere. Words are spirit and they are life. So, whatever you're speaking, whatever is speaking, it's coming from the realm of the spirit and it's going to give life to whatever it is. So when that contrary voice is trying to convince you to have sex, it's speaking those things to get you to go that direction, giving life to that sin, giving life to that action. You've got to be aware. If you've got God's counsel on a matter, you don't give up and give into it. You check it and you correct it with what? God's word. He has to be the final authority in your life. You cannot yield yourself to temptation like that. Understand that if what you are being encouraged to do or instructed to do is not in line with God's word, it is the contrary voice of the devil. What Eve was instructed to do, what she was encouraged to do, where did it come from? It didn't come from her own mind because she did not have that intellect. The intellect she had was, I must not touch that tree. I must not eat from that tree or I will die. That's what God told her. That settled the matter. Here comes a contrary voice. Did he really say, nah, you're not going to die? As a matter of fact, go ahead and eat from it. He just don't want you to know that you're going to be like him. Sinful, wicked intellect entered in. She ain't checked and corrected. But we're going to continue. Understand this. Keep in mind that what you allow to have a conversation with you, when you're allowing the conversation to continue, is called entertaining. You are entertaining a conversation. with something that's seeking to kill you. Like how they say, sleeping with the enemy. Just because it's talking to you doesn't mean it loves you. Just because it's talking to you doesn't mean it's your friend.
That's right.
Just because it's talking to you doesn't mean it likes you. God is the only one who loves you unconditionally. But what are you entertaining? Also, understand that what you entertain, the voice you entertain, you're going to give it more influence. The influence of that voice is going to increase upon you. What you entertain, that voice you are entertaining, is going to increase its influence on you to do what it desires you to do. Write that down. So if you are entertaining God's counsel, you entertain God's spirit when you worship, when you pray, when you cry out to him, when you read the word, you're spending time with him, you're entertaining the presence of the Almighty. Understand that. And you're going to do what? Increase his influence upon you to do what he desires you to do, which is only the righteous thing, the right thing, the good thing, that which leads to life, eternal life, life everlasting. But if you entertain hanging out with a bunch of drunks, y'all get together, y'all got to go have a drink, happy hour. We got to go get it in one time, you know. It's been a stressful week, so, you know, I got to go get me a drink. How that song go? How you say, let me buy you a drink. Yeah, T-Pain. Yeah, let's go get drunk. He got money in the bank. And after that, we're going to go travel a little bit, and we're going to go spend all this money. Oh, we got to stop by the strip club. We got to make it rain. Because, you know, having a girlfriend or a man, that just ain't really my thing. So we hanging out with each other. A bunch of us rebels are hanging out together. But you kind of toting the line. Because your conscience of God, you're conscious of God. And you kind of got something sitting there. But you're hanging with this crowd. What influence do you think is going to increase in your life? Especially when you don't check it and correct it.
Come on here.
Like David said, thy word have I hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you. Do you hide God's word in your heart that you wouldn't sin against him? This is how you hide it in your heart. God said, don't do this. That's a boundary marker in my life. So when the next joker comes up and says, hey, let's go do this. Man, let's go get toe up. Let's go get lit. Let's get litty this weekend. I have God's word as a boundary marker in my life that says what? Be not drunk with wine, but be drunk with the spirit. Here's one for you. Them same people, invite them. Invite them to come get litty in the spirit. Let's see how quick they leave you alone. Amen.
Amen.
1 Corinthians 14 verse 10. Again, 1 Corinthians 14 verse 10. And the King James Version reads, there are, it may be, so many kinds of voices in the world, and none of them is without significance. You must understand every voice speaking to you has some level of significance. It has some ability to persuade you, to convince you. That's why you have to be careful who you lend your ear to. Is it in line with God's word, or is it contrary to what God is saying? Every voice is significant. Whether it's your mother telling you, come on, baby, let's go to the club, because they themselves still ain't found God. That's a significant voice in your life. Or how about the voice of a spouse? They can definitely help make and break you, if you allow them to. Every voice has significance, so you have to be careful and pay attention to who you lend your ear to. Our ears are important gateways to the inward man, to our region, our spiritual region. You have to guard it with diligence. You have to guard it with diligence. It's not something you do passively. You have to be intentional about what you allow to come in here. Don't allow just anything to come in here. Say, I will guard my heart. Type it out. I will guard my heart. Remember, Pastor just taught that the heart is your mind, your appetite. Say, I will guard my heart. And now that we see that the first error is allowing a contrary voice to get our attention, to get into our ear gates, we're moving on to the second point. Second point being this: convincing leads to conceiving and then committing. Again, point number two. Convincing leads to conceiving, then to committing. Just giving y'all a moment to write it down. Take any personal notes. Now, under this point number two, Genesis chapter 3, verse 6. We're going to look at. It reads, the woman was convinced. Again, the woman was convinced. She saw that the tree was beautiful and its fruit looked delicious, and she wanted the wisdom it would give her. So she took some of the fruit and ate it. Then she gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it too. But it started at her being convinced. Notice that once Eve was convinced, after having this conversation with the contrary voice, crossing the boundaries God had set to protect her and Adam, actually began to seem restrictive to their human and spiritual experience. Again, notice that once Eve was convinced after having the conversation with a contrary voice who we know was the devil, crossing the boundaries God had set to protect her and Adam, actually began to seem restrictive to both their human and spiritual experience. You can actually hear these kinds of remarks made amongst people who say they're spiritual. Not saved, but spiritual.
Yeah.
Oh, well, you know, I don't like being confined within the tenets of religion or organized religion.
Mm-mm. Come on, go ahead.
And yes, I say that with an attitude because it's the voice of the enemy. They entertained the wrong voice for too long. Now that influence has increased in their life to where they really think they have stepped into another sphere of spirituality, not knowing that they're dead. Mm. You are not spiritual without God. Let me explain that again. Mm. You're not spiritual apart from the Spirit of God. Without Him, you're dead, and you're going to learn why. Like I said, that which was meant to protect her and Adam, the boundaries God had set to protect, the enemy convinced her that, nah, God lying to you. Not only was he lying, but trying to keep all this power for himself. This is what the devil convinced her of. So now, what happened? Proper perspective went out the window. Mm. Because now she began to conceive. She became pregnant with the wrong seed. Yes, words are seeds. It's scripture. She began to conceive in her womb. Wrong intellect, evil intellect. And what was that intellect? God lying to me. Rather than trying to protect me when he told me not to go near that tree or I would die, I guess I'm going to be in competition with him now because I want the wisdom that he got. And since he ain't going to give it to me, I'm going to get it the way I want to get it. So I'm going to eat from that tree like this voice just told me. Improper intellect. Wicked intellect. If God wants you to have it, he will give it to you. You don't go about it the way you want to get it. This is why you see a lot of people that are in Wiccan and all this witchcraft and doing all this black magic, all this foolishness, because they're trying to get into a level of power that belongs to the divine.
Lord have mercy.
You're going about it the way you want to go about it, and you don't realize you're going about it the wrong way. If you would just connect yourself to God, he'll give you the desires of your heart. Ain't nothing but power in God. Nothing but. But she tapped into sinful intellect. She began to conceive that which she had no business conceiving.
Go ahead.
She conceived sin in her heart. Now, Eve began to see something that was meant to kill her. That tree had no life in it. None. As a matter of fact, what was the tree that God wanted them to eat from? Come, Pastor, I want you to tell me, because I know the word. There was another tree in that beautiful garden. And it was the tree of what?
Tree of life.
Oh! The tree of life, that was the tree that she was supposed to eat from, that Adam was supposed to eat from, that we all should have been able to be going to right now and eating from. But because she entertained the wrong thing for too long, Let me tell you, she began to see that which was meant to kill her as tempting, good, desirable, and even irresistible. It's like looking right into the eyes of a rattlesnake. But now all of a sudden, oh, it's just so adorable. It's so cute. Oh, maybe I should touch it. This thing will kill you. It possesses poison in it. A poison that you can't just get out when you want to. And this tree, God said to stay away from it, but she began to see it. Let's look at this. She was in a conversation. Let's pay attention to the rotation here. She was in a conversation with a contrary voice, number one, that took time to convince her, number two, that doing the opposite, it convinced her that doing the opposite of what God, oh, okay. What's that about? Oh, I'm sorry, y'all. Okay, but like I said, it took time to convince her that doing the opposite of what God said was okay, which then she conceived. So the contrary voice came in, she entertained it too long. That gave it influence and the ability to do what? Convince her. It's the same thing that happens with us. Now, she conceived erroneous thoughts and sin in her heart, which led Eve to finally commit the act of breaking God's boundaries. Again, she was in a conversation with a contrary voice that took time to convince her that doing the opposite of what God said was okay, which then she conceived in her own mind the erroneous thoughts and the sin in her heart, which then led her to finally commit the actual act of eating the fruit and passing it along to her husband who was with her.
Mm-hmm. No.
Pastor said you on your own.
Hallelujah.
Well, amen. You ain't gonna eat it. But, you know, this is what happened. This is the process to transgression. But it all starts with that ear gate. Who are you listening to? And if he had had a good mind, which he did, he should have been like, God, she over here talking to this thing. They done talked up, eating some fruit. That ain't that. Mm-mm. Nope. But he was never deceived. He ain't even have to be convinced. He just ate it. Adam just ate it. James 1, verse 15. In the Amplified, again, James chapter 1, verse 15, in the Amplified, says, then when the illicit desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And when sin has run its course, it gives birth to death. The Passion Translation reads it like this: evil desires give birth to evil actions, and when sin is fully mature, it can murder you. You got to understand this. When we're talking about she conceived this thing, The enemy was no longer talking to Eve. Pastor, the enemy had already backed off. He had already sown his seed. She, what did the scripture say? It said the woman was convinced. She saw that the tree was beautiful and its fruit looked delicious, and she wanted the wisdom it would give her. She conceived it in her mind. She was already there. She didn't have to be convinced any further. The devil was no longer talking to her. She was in the process of committing the transgression. She already had it set in her mind. She was meditating on it. She was pondering. Now, I just got to make the step. And she made the move. And she touched it. And realized, wait a minute. I didn't die. So this voice wasn't lying. So now she's seeing God as the liar. Then, well, let me eat it then. Because surely if that wasn't a lie, then me eating it ain't going to be a lie. And I'm going to get the wisdom I want. It's all about me. Eat the fruit. I didn't drop dead. Hey, baby, here. You take a bite. He bit into it. He didn't drop dead. But uh-oh, here comes this little known fact. Whenever you do wrong, what happens? You feel guilty. You feel shame. And they had broken a boundary. And what was the first thing they began to experience? Verse 7. At that moment, their eyes were opened and they suddenly felt shame. They had crossed the boundary. They had messed up. And the first thing they felt was shame. Is that not what we feel when we go too far? I know when I was in the world and I had sex outside of marriage, I know that once I had did it, I don't care how good it felt or how sorry it felt, I felt shame. I felt embarrassment because I knew, instinctively I knew, that I should not have been doing it. You know when you've done wrong. Also, Romans chapter 5, verse 12. Romans chapter 5, verse 12, in the Passion Translation, it reads, when Adam sinned, the entire world was affected. Sin entered human experience, and death was the result. And so death followed this sin, casting its shadow over all humanity, because all have sinned. None of us are without guilt. Because of what they did, we all are under this shadow. It is what it is. We can't exclude ourselves from it. It is what it is. We are all underneath the weight of this particular experience. Sin and death. It doesn't feel good. It doesn't feel right. No, you may not have done anything yet, but you did it. And it sounds crazy. It sounds crazy. It's just like a baby being born in a trap house.
To shine.
That baby didn't say, hey, put me in a crack house where they're selling drugs, where people finna run in and shoot the whole house up and everything in it. Why should I have to experience death? I just got here. But because of what one man did, we all are underneath the weight of this experience of sin and death. All of us are under this condition. and we need a Savior. Every last one of us. Hallelujah. None of us are so good and not bad enough that we don't need Christ. I want you to write down these definitions really quick before we move into our third point. Definitions for you to know. There's only two of them. The first one is death. Death. In the Greek, the word death is thanatos. Thanatos. And it's spelled THANATOS. Again, that's THANATOS. Thanatos. And it means the separation of man from God. And we're talking about the conscious existence in separation from God, not a no longer living physically type situation. Notice when Adam and Eve ate the fruit, they did not drop. They did not drop, turn black, turn back to dust. She popped back into a rib. Nothing of that nature. When they ate the fruit that day, they died. They experienced death. And that is what? The separation of man from God. They disregarded his word. Disregarded his protection. Disregarded the hedge that God had enclosed them with. And the word talks about when the hedge is broken, the serpent will bite. And that's exactly what Satan did. We're going to get into that later on. But this is the kind of death that entered into the human experience immediately. Also physically later on, because man could not live forever in this condition. Changes had to be made. Second definition is sin. The second definition is sin. And in the Greek, the word sin is hamartano. Hamartano. And it is spelled HAMARTANO. Again, HAMARTANO. Hamartano. And it means to miss the mark. To miss the mark. Also, to wander from the path. To wander from the path of uprightness and honor. To wander from the path of uprightness and honor. Also, to do or go wrong. To do or go wrong. Also, to violate. To violate God's law. If you got it, I want you to type, got it. so that we properly see what death is and not be deceived by the enemy. Because if you go and sin tomorrow, it does not mean that you're going to drop dead when you do it. That's the deceptiveness of the enemy right there. Is that, no, surely you're not going to die. Sure. Oh yeah, he tried to convince her. No, you're not going to die. You're not going to drop dead physically. But what she did not know was that death was another way. And because she ate that fruit and she gave it to Adam, who ate it, sin and death entered into the human experience. And we all have to pay the price. But we're not the only ones. God had to pay a high price. For the word tells us that the Lamb was slain before the foundations of the earth. God had already prepared for what could and eventually what would occur. So don't look at it as, oh, that was the Jewish people, that was the Pharisees, that was them who put him on that cross. No, this weekend we celebrate the resurrection of our beautiful Savior because it was our sin that put him on that cross. Thank you, Jesus. Proper perspective. Proper. Point number three is Christ is the only Savior. Christ is the only Savior. And Pastor, this is where I want you to help me out, sir. One second, everybody. Gonna get this up here quickly. The first one is Acts chapter 4, verse 12. In this section, I'm going to let the word, I'm going to let God, I'm going to let his spirit speak straight to you. It doesn't have to be about all the beautiful words and all of these things that I can come up with. It's not about me. It's about him. Amen. We're going to get back to the preaching of Christ. Amen. Acts chapter 4, verse 12 in the New Living Translation, everybody. Listen closely.
There is salvation in no one else. God has given no other name under heaven by which we must be saved.
Hallelujah. Scripture number 2, Romans chapter 5, verse 17. New Living Translation. Romans, again, that's Romans chapter 5, verse 17.
Romans 5, 17. For the sin of this one man, Adam, caused death to rule over many. But even greater is God's wonderful grace and his gift of righteousness. For all who receive it will live in triumph over sin and death through this one man, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Christ is the only.
Hallelujah.
There is no other name. No other name, everybody.
Thank you, Father.
He's the only one. Only. And we're going to continue. John chapter 14, verse 6. And this is the Lord speaking.
Jesus told him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me.
This is the Lord speaking directly to y'all. To me and to you, to Pastor and to you. This is the word of God. Jesus is letting you know there is no other way. No other way. He is the way, the truth, and the life. You're not going to get back to the Father. You're not going to come out of death and into life apart from Him. All right. Now, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24 through 25. Again, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24 through 25.
He personally carried our sins in His body on the cross, so that we can be dead to sin and live for what is right. By His wounds, you are healed. Once you were like sheep who wandered away, but now you have turned to your shepherd, the guardian of your souls.
Do you hear that? He's expecting you to turn to Him as your shepherd, as the one who guides you and leads you, the one in whom you can trust, who wants the best for you, watching over your soul, watching over my soul, watching over Pastor's soul, watching over our souls. And he says, what again? Oh, He personally carried all of these sins that are trying to take us out. He personally carried all these sins in His own body on the cross. Nobody else did it. Don't you let no contrary voice come to you and tell you there's another way to God. There is no such. Nobody else went to that cross like that. He who was without sin was made to be sin for you, for me, for all who would live wrong, so that we could do what? Live for what is right. And the final scripture here is John chapter 3, verse 3, and then verse 6.
John chapter 3, verse 3. Jesus replied, I tell you the truth, unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. Verse 6. Humans can reproduce only human life, but the Holy Spirit gives birth to spiritual life. Hallelujah.
Understand this. If you do not have the Holy Spirit, if you are not living in Christ Jesus, hallelujah, you will not enter the kingdom of God. The sacrifice He gave was too high. It was too precious. And it was too thorough for it to just be looked over, passed over, like it was nothing. He loves us too much. He cared too much. Too much. He saw the condition we were in and had already made a plan before the foundation of this earth, before the foundation of this world. He had already had a plan in place because He had already loved us, each and every one. It's not too late for you. It's not too late for me. It's not too late for the person you know. He got up on the third day. He rose up with all power. All power. And He turned right back around and said, here you go. Now reign in this earth. That's the God we serve. That's the God who loves us thoroughly, fully, completely. But you cannot get to Him if you do not get to Christ, because Christ serves in the position of Savior for all of us. You've got to give your life to Christ. You have to be born again. You heard what the Lord said. Do not be surprised that I tell you this, that you must be born again. Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit is the one who gives life. You can't go around him. You can't go about him and just go, oh, I'm spiritual. I'm just a spiritual person. You know, I don't like organized religion. Let me explain something to you. This is the best organized religion I know. And the reason why is because God said that everything that's done must be done decently and in order. Outside of that is what? Chaos. And God is not the author of confusion. There are people in this earth that have misrepresented him, but you cannot take that out on God because they did you wrong. It's time to get back right. It's time to come back to Christ. It's time to get your life back in order. It's time to get rid of the anger. It's time to get rid of the sadness. It's time to get rid of the frustration. You got work to do. It's time for you to co-labor with the love of your life. It's time for you to stand in the truth. And Jesus said that he is the truth. And the truth shall set you free. The truth shall set you free. For whom the Son sets free is free indeed. And that's truth. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. And that is your word for tonight. Amen.
Hallelujah.
So, Pastor, would you like to add anything?
Nothing to add. To God be the glory. I just feel good. I showed self-control tonight because I wanted to jack a preach. I wanted to dive in that thing. But Jesus is so wonderful. I'm just happy. I love God. I'm excited. It's, you know, this is the week that we remember his passion. Of course, it's every day.
Yes.
But this week, of course, if no other time, you know, we set the focus. We set the attention. We think about the passion of the Christ. We saw the depiction. Mm-hmm. You know, we saw the movie to actually be able to get a visual of what, you know, our Lord and Savior has done for us. And it's just a marvelous thing that, you know, truly those broken boundaries, that transgression, you know, there's a high price. It's not to be taken lightly. You know, it's not just a passive little, I'm just, you know, can't control myself and, you know, just playing around. Like, look at what it cost Jesus. You know, look at what we did to him. But we give God thanks. Hallelujah. I'm getting excited. Yes. I'm getting excited. Yes. Praise the Lord. We thank God. We thank you, Father. We thank God for what he's done for us and to bring these things to our remembrance. And it's just marvelous. I'm happy.
Amen. So
feel good.
Yeah. So everybody just keep in mind that this weekend, it's not about the best Easter suit. That has nothing to do with it. It's resurrection weekend. We are celebrating the Lord. We're celebrating all that he sacrificed for us. And the fact that he rose up with all power. Amen. He got up with all power. And then had the audacity to return it to us. Oh my Lord. Is he not amazing? Is he not a God worth serving? Y'all, you better fall in love with him all over again.
Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name.
He's worth it. Oh, he's worth it. He loves you so much. So, Pastor, you want to lead the people into prayer?
Again, like we said, Jesus loves us all so much. Bible says we're the apple of his eye and we're his greatest desire. I mean, he gave everything. The Bible says if he, you know, gave everything for us, if he didn't even hold back his own son, how much more will he freely give all things to us? And I mean, we're never too far. We're never outside of God's reach. We're never too far. We're just one prayer. God is one prayer away. He's already there. but to just connect and reconnect. God is just always standing there with open arms, just ready and waiting and willing and able. His mercies are new every morning, and he loves us with an everlasting love. We said he's not a man.
Yeah.
He's not like man. His love isn't like ours. We don't repel God and push him away. You know, he wants us to repent and come to him. He loves us so he can restore us, so he can bless us, so he can, you know, get us where he would have us to be. So if you've never accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, if you don't know where you would spend eternity, I mean, people are leaving the earth daily. I mean, it's happening. There's one appointment we all will make. At some point, we got to leave the earth.
Yeah.
So we want to be ready. We can live ready. We can live with confidence. We can live with assurance. Hallelujah. So if you haven't, just take a moment and you can pray along with us. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we come before you tonight and we just acknowledge, Lord, according to your word, we have sinned. We have transgressed. Lord, we have missed the mark. We have violated your laws and we violated your word. Your word says we've all like sheep, we've all gone astray, God. We've chosen our own way. And Lord, we ask for your forgiveness. We ask you to forgive us tonight. We ask you to wash us and clean us and cleanse us and purge us from all unrighteousness, Lord. Deliver us tonight. All that shame and all the fear and everything that sin brings along with it. Father, mend every brokenness. In the name of Jesus, we come tonight accepting Lord Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. We believe you died on the cross, Lord, for our sins, and we believe you were powerfully resurrected, hallelujah, for our redemption and our eternal salvation. And we accept you tonight. We receive you tonight. We ask you, come into our hearts, change our lives, transform us. Write our names in the Lamb's Book of Life. We want to be with you, Lord. We thank you tonight, and we praise you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Mm. Lord, all of us can use a fresh start. May have transgressed just a minute ago. Might have got a little upset. May have thought of a curse word in the mind. Anything. Look, all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God's awesome holy standard. But guess what? Although we may have transgressed the boundary, Christ said, guess what? Just repent. Repent. That doesn't mean apologize and keep doing it. But repent and turn your back on that thing and come back the right way. Make a U-turn. Come on back toward the right way, the righteous standard. Come on, you can do it because he empowers you to do it. You're not doing it on your own. That's why you must receive the Holy Spirit, because he helps you. He empowers you. He gives you God's counsel. This is not for you to do on your own. He gives you both the desire and the will to do what pleases him. But you must be born again. And you got to begin to yield to him. Even in the small things, apologize if you're wrong. Simple things. But this is your word for tonight. Sin and death entered our camp, but by Christ we reign over sin and death. It has no hold on us believers. No, it doesn't. Amen. So on that, we thank God for tonight, for being able to share it with you all. We love you. You already know this. But now we are going to go into you being able to give tonight. I mean, we thank you so much for being with us tonight. We love each and every one of you. This has been an awesome time with you. You guys are such an encouragement to us.
Man, I'm telling you.
We love y'all. But yes, you know, go ahead and give. You know, if you're a member, you already know your tithe. You know, your tithe comes here as well as your offerings. Amen. But other than that, you know, if you're just a friend, a partner of the ministry, then, you know, your offering is more than enough. You know, you send your tithe to your home church. Amen. And so the way that you can give is through the Ministry Cash app. and that is $AWPM. Again, that is $AWPM. Amen. I think Pastor's typing it in. Amen. And then also, you already know you can come by and check us out on our website. That's www.awpm.org. We want you to come by, check us out, leave us a message, something, you know, hit us up, let us know. We love you. Anything else you'd like to add?
Hallelujah. I'll be sure to tune in. We're still here. On Sunday, of course, it's going to be on fire. Hallelujah. I love it. I love it. I'm ready. I'm studying. I'm praying. I just tune in 10 a.m. on Sunday.
Yes.
We will be here. Hallelujah. And of course, next week, Wednesday, she did an amazing job. Hallelujah. It's growing. It's building. It's honing in. Hallelujah. The Lord wants to rebuild our lives. He sees us. He sees the broken state of humanity. He saw the broken state. And he's made the steps necessary to mend us, to heal us, to deliver us. And just somebody, God doesn't hate you. Mm. God doesn't hate you. God's not mad at you.
Yeah.
God loves you with an everlasting and eternal love. The Bible says it's the goodness of God that draws men to repentance.
Mm-hmm.
It's not his will that any should perish. The most wicked out here. And we're seeing all kind of stuff going down, and it's upsetting.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's appalling, and it should be. There's righteous indignation. But at the end of the day, God still loves them, and he wants them saved. So tune in on Sunday, and we're going to be back on Wednesday. And we love you, and we're praying for you. Again, just drop us a line. We're here. Hallelujah. And we love you. We thank each and every one of you for tuning in. And God bless you.
God bless you. We are so looking forward to coming back and spending more time with you Sunday. You already know, 10 o'clock a.m. getting our worship on.
Come on here. Hallelujah.
With your excited pastor.
I'm excited. Amen. God is good.
And so with that being said, thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Jesus
for tuning
to the rescue.
In tonight. Yes. Jesus to the rescue. He's coming through for all of us. He is our only savior, and we need him, and we're going to celebrate him this weekend. Amen. Hallelujah. Love you.